If you were at a restaurant sitting down and like jellyfish was on the menu, you would probably order literally anything else. Like, I can't tell you what you definitely do, but there's basically nothing there. They're 95% water, nothing you can sink your teeth into. Now, celery is also 95% water, but at least it goes well with wings and ranch, you know, not just by itself. Yet, some species of sea turtles, like the loggerhead and the leatherback, eat almost nothing but jellyfish, leaving scientists asking how in the world they can live on something similarly lacking in oomph. Which, like, we need to know, because human activity is changing the way nutrients move through the oceans, and jellyfish can teach us a surprising amount about what ends up where. Considering jellies are made up of water and, like, stings, it's no wonder scientists used to be pretty convinced that jellyfish were dead weight within their food webs. At best, they were believed to contribute very little to the ecosystem. At worst, it was thought they shunted nutrients away from other species in the food web. Remember that food webs are all about how nutrients move through an ecosystem. From things like carbon and nitrogen to more minor nutrients, everything's constantly moving in a cycle. At least, it's best for everyone involved if that's the case. So how is it that certain animals can survive perfectly well on a diet so heavy in jellyfish sea celery? Okay, well, jellyfish do provide some nutrients, and not all of them are from the jelly itself. Jellyfish primarily eat plankton and other small food sources. They catch their prey by stabbing them with their stinging nematocyst cells in their tentacles and then trapping them in their mucus. The leftover dissolved and digested prey leave behind a lot of carbon in that mucus, enough to support the growth of bacteria in the surrounding waters. What's more, predators of jellyfish seem to know how to get the best bang for their buck. They've been observed eating only the most nutritious parts of the jellyfish, often leaving behind the less nutritious upper bell portion. They get up to 5 times more nutrients this way, and probably a healthy dose of collagen, too, a building block for cartilage that jellyfish are full of. Now, a potential problem arises, though, when jellyfish bloom. Jellyfish can explode in population numbers when warm water conditions permit. When this happens, jellies may overhunt their prey and funnel those nutrients into what's called a sink, preventing carbon and other nutrients from going to other consumers in the food web. If jellyfish blooms were sequestering nutrients and energy in the environment, it could spell disaster for all of the organisms connected to them if nutrients weren't available for other members of the food web. And with warmer oceans thought to be driving more and more blooms, this could be yet another nasty effect of the climate crisis. Thankfully, marine scientists are using more sophisticated tools to observe and closely measure how you get nutrients back out of a jellyfish, which happens more than we used to think. Now, untangling food webs can be pretty tricky. The first problem is that since jellyfish are pretty much jelly, there isn't much left behind to find in predators' stomachs. Being mostly water, jellyfish are digested really quickly. It takes a keen eye with a microscope to look through recent stomach contents of predators for evidence of tentacles and their stinging nematocysts. Stable isotope analysis is an advanced tool that can help identify what kind of food sources make up an animal's diet. Isotopes, or variants of elements like carbon and nitrogen, appear in predictable ratios in an animal's tissue depending on if the animal is an herbivore or a carnivore, for example. This is how we know that some supposedly herbivorous sea turtles are actually eating a whole lot of jellyfish. Species that were believed to be completely vegetarian, including the green and black sea turtles, have been found to opportunistically make use of jellyfish as food when blooms provide lots of them. And we found that it's more than just turtles who enjoy a jelly snack. All good blooms must come to an end. When conditions return to normal, jellies can die off en masse, providing a lot of easy food to animals living on the deep ocean floor. Some deep-dwelling animals, including hagfish, crabs, and lobsters, will take advantage of this bounty. Then there's the bluefin tuna, who hunt live jellies. This is actually a good way to get back at jellyfish, who also like to eat tuna eggs and larvae. Speaking of babies, lobster larvae also enjoy a jellyfish delicacy. They even have specializations to disarm jellyfish stings, making them safe to eat. Findings made possible by new methodology show that even albatross and penguins have been found to prey on jellyfish when the opportunity presents itself. They're super easy to catch and quick to digest, making them, if anything, a rather nice addition to a balanced diet. Turns out, just because we couldn't figure out how at first, doesn't mean that jellyfish aren't actually a valuable and integrated part of their food webs in numbers big and small. And being able to understand their place in the ecosystem makes them an important consideration as conservationists monitor changes in ocean temperature, fishing trends, and marine animal population changes. Not bad for a bit of sea celery. Now, jellyfish may be the balloons of the sea, but if you want to see the balloons of space, we have a sticker sheet of unlikely space balloons in our merch store at dftba.com/scishow. They are holographic and shiny and extremely good for sticking on your water bottle or laptop. That's only one of the many fine SciShow-themed products, and in fact, we are looking to expand our offerings. So hit us up with any requests or ideas in the comments. If you want to check out the sticker sheet and everything else yet to come, head to the link in the description, and thank you for watching.